Ham Radio Now, episode 138, MotoTRBOStar, or something like that. Yeah, I'm Gary Pierce, Scan for AQ. This is the bear. Hey, bear. Say hi to everybody. That's the bear. He'll sit down here in my lap for as much of the show as he cares to stick around for. So after doing a couple of episodes that went into the absolute core of ham radio, HFD expeditions, I now drag you back kicking and screaming into the realm of VHF and digital voice modes. Just after I got a whole bunch of DXers to sign up and subscribe to the YouTube channel, and some of them even sent me some money. So sorry about that, but that's where we're going to go for this episode and probably the next one or two. Not necessarily all digital voice, but digital stuff. And then we'll work on some more of that core, you know, HF DX contest, stuff like that. Especially if you guys volunteer and let me know who the good people to talk to would be here on the Skype. First, of course, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Arvin, Chief Financial Officer, wants me to drag you over to the website, hamradionow.tv. If you find that you're interested in the programs, get some value out of them, you can make a contribution that helps me pay for all this fancy TV equipment that I'm staring into, and the websites, and make some money myself, because I'm doing this practically full-time, and when I go to McDonald's and buy a Happy Meal, they won't give it to me in trade for a podcast. They want cash. So I need to be able to take a little bit of that with me. Right, Bear? Bear says, yeah, send Daddy some cash. All right, so that's it for that. HamRadioNow.tv. Just stop by there. So on my Skype is CEO and president of Connect Systems. It is Jerry Wanger. I've got that right? Wanger like a ranger?
That's correct.
My memory is pretty bad. And the reason we're talking to you is something that you guys are planning on doing. This isn't your website here. This is the website of some folks you gave an interview to, VA3XPR, announcing a new radio, a combination of DMR and D-Star. And that is going to have a lot of people very excited, because up until now, the only source for D-Star radios you could hold in your hand, has been ICOM. There have been various D-Star peripherals and some ways you could jeep D-Star into analog radios, but none of them were particularly elegant and none of them were handheld. And so what you're talking about doing is becoming the first company to make a D-Star radio besides ICOM. And I'm going to say it's got DMR, what most people refer to as MotoTRBO, going along for the ride. That's probably backwards. It started as a MotoTRBO radio and is getting D-Star added onto it. Is that a better way to describe it?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And you can't call it MotoTRBO. You can't brand it as MotoTRBO, because that's what is a Motorola brand name?
Yeah, it's a trademark of Motorola. So if we use the word MotoTRBO in riding, we have to say MotoTRBO is a trademark of Motorola.
But it is essentially compatible. It talks to the Moto. I mean, in the amateur world, where this DMR stuff is building up fairly quickly in the U.S. and around the world, they call it MotoTRBO. DMR is also a specific. I don't know if it's not a trade name, not a brand name, but the initials stand for digital mobile radio, but I mean, D-Star would be digital mobile radio. DMR still refers to this basic protocol of digital radio, right?
Correct. It's an ETSI standard, and ETSI is a European organization that produces standards. So we're compatible with ETSI Tier 1 and Tier 2. Tier 3 and Tier 4 is used for trunking and for roaming. Motorola does Tier 3 and Tier 4, but their own proprietary version, which means we can't copy them, because they have it patented. So we can come up with the functions that they do, but we can't use something that's compatible with their radios.
Okay. That will primarily be in the commercial service. In the amateur DMR network, nobody's doing trunking as far as I know. What about roaming?
Yeah, roaming people have used, particularly in other countries. About a month ago, I got a call from somebody from England who says that they needed the roaming feature because they were in this hilly area and they couldn't reach all the repeaters from where they are. So whenever they move, they have to go to a different repeater. Now, the way around that without trunking is real simple. You just change a channel knob to whichever is the best repeater.
Okay. Well, let's take a step back and look at some big picture here first. Your company, CSI, let me dial up your website, Connect Systems Incorporated, you got a bunch of VHF and UHF radios. I see a lot of these are called analog. A few of them are called digital. LTR is a form of trunking. And the one that had gotten hams very excited, the hams especially who have been using MotoTRBO, is this one, the CS700. And that's analog and DMR, am I right?
Correct. We also make another digital radio called the CS600, which is for the commercial markets. And the only difference between that and a 700 is it doesn't have a keyboard or display, which for the commercial market is very useful because all they want the people to do is push the button to speak, and that's it.
Okay, so the CS700, this radio, is specifically aimed at the amateur market?
No, I wouldn't say specifically. It's aimed at both markets. A lot of people still like the display. If you have a lot of different people calling you, you sometimes like to know who it is calling. The CS600 has 32 channels. CS700 has 1,000. But more important, if you're working with more than just a few channels, you don't know what channel you're on unless you look at the display. Could you imagine having a 32-channel system and trying to remember who's, you know, what each channel stands for? You know, so even for commercial people, you know, that they need the display.
Yeah. I've got this this radio I've had for a while. It's a analog and P25 digital. It's the Johnson's probably most basic version, and if I can get it there. Its channel switch has got 16 positions and then an ABC, which triples the 16 positions, and I have no idea what I've got programmed in it anymore. But the 700 is not so much the radio that we're interested in. This DMR plus D-Star, its model number is going to be 7,000, and it is not available yet, right?
No. I just started working on it about a week ago, and my estimated time for completion is less than 6 months.
That seems like a pretty fast turnaround.
It is, but we already got the basic hardware design. It's just a few more minor details that I have to work out.
We're going to have people who are interested in D-Star, people who are interested in MotoTRBO, and people who are just kind of interested but don't really, haven't joined either group, haven't bought a digital radio. They're just kind of curious what this is all about. So we'll try to address a little bit to each one, but I think we need to throw a little bit of red meat to the folks about this radio. Give me some of the basics of what this radio is going to be capable of doing.
Well, the basic concept is having both DMR and D-Star. Oh, that's the basic part. The more advanced part is that I have enough horsepower in this system where I can add features that cannot be put into our competitors' radios. They just don't have enough memory space, and if they don't have enough, the computers just aren't fast enough. One of the reasons for using the vocoder I'm using, which happens to be the AMBE 3000, which is advanced version of what's been used in the ICOM radios, which is the AMBE 2020. One is I have less, takes less power, and two, it adds features which just aren't available within that generation of radios. And there's a lot of features what I'm going to be putting in, and I'm not going to discuss that at this time. They're right now proprietary. We'll discuss some of those things at the Dayton Ham Convention or earlier if I get up to 2,000 people signed up to my CS7000 Yahoo group.
Okay, so you got some secrets that you're not willing to reveal here on Ham Radio Now. But it sounds like you're going to be going to the Dayton Hamvention. You're going to have a booth there?
Yeah, I'm going to have a booth, but I'm not going to actually have any radios to sell. I will take orders there, and we could probably ship within a day or two after we get, after I get back from Dayton. But no physical radios to sell.
And you're talking about the radios you've got on the market right now. Again, the 7000, the D-Star DMR combo radio, not on the market until maybe in the fall.
Correct. We will hopefully see a hardware prototype of the CS7000, but definitely not going to be finished with the software.
People are going to be trying to give you pre-orders for that. I don't imagine you're going to be taking orders for that yet.
I've already got one firm order with a credit card, although okay. I told him I won't charge it until we're ready to ship. And I had another person who was asking me to give a firm order, but I wasn't at a place where I could write his information down. So I said, just go back, later. So the answer is yes.
So Dayton, you'll...
we're going to take a special order form just for the 7,000 so people can, to pre-order the thing.
Okay, cool. And then the other thing that you were referring to, let me see if I can bring this up, is your Yahoo group. People are going to get interested in this radio pretty quickly. And you've got a place not only to get information, but a place, a Yahoo group that you created and are interacting with people every day. It's groups.yahoo.com, and the group name is CS7000. Which is going to be the model number of the radio. It's not a moderated group, it doesn't appear, but you do have to sign up through you. Sign up for the group, and then you'll approve the membership.
Right. Whatever anybody wants to say, they can say. I'm not going to take it down. Unless they just put spam up, but I haven't seen any of that yet.
Hams are generally pretty good. They can get a little bit trolly, but they're generally pretty good, especially in a group like that someone's looking at things.
Yeah. But sometimes you see in these groups, somebody put up advertisements for things like drugs and other stuff like that. Those I'll take down.
Yeah. I've got a Yahoo group for Ham Radio Now, and I haven't seen anything like that. At least not yet. Now I'm just asked for it, but you haven't seen that sort of stuff. So if someone's interested in this, they should stop by. And I was saying that you're responsive. You answer questions and talk to people over there.
Correct. Yeah, also speak to them over the phone, not just, through the Yahoo groups. One of the things I'm doing on that Yahoo group is I'm explaining at this time the hardware features of the unit, going to give some, details about what we have in there. The people who want to develop applications and other things, for these types of products, they're going to see the details. And shortly, I'm going to start doing the software programming, and I'm going to release a lot of the software, the actual source code on, the Yahoo group, so people can take a look at. They may criticize, may tell me that here's a better way of doing things.
Are you going to officially release it as open source, or are you just going to let pieces out that people can look at?
I'm not going to release it what you think is open source. I haven't made a firm decision on that, but I will. I will show all or most of the software that's in it, at least for the D-Star. For the DMR, I probably won't show any of it, and not because I don't want to, but because it's not mine.
You're designing these radios. You're not manufacturing them, right?
Correct. Yeah, if I had to manufacture it, it would probably be at least double what I'm selling it for right now. I can't buy the parts for what I can sell it for. If I want to buy a particular IC from a Chinese manufacturer, they're going to give me one price. If the people who were buying radios from ask for the same part, they're going to get it for less than I'm getting it for.
Okay, so they can build the whole radio cheaper than you can buy the parts.
Exactly.
So you're having basically a Chinese fabricator build the radios to your specs.
Yes.
Okay. And the radio that that you'll be building is going to be monoband, just 2 meters or just 70 centimeters, but you're not going to make a dual band radio, at least not now?
No, we're going to just cover the 400 to 470 band and the 2 meter band.
Yep.
I can't right now. I can't think offhand the frequency range of the VHF, but it does cover both before and after the 144 megahertz frequency range.
144 to 148 is the ham band. And I guess I should explain, you're not a ham, at least not now.
No, I used to be a ham. Reason why I didn't continue was because I can never go above 5 words a minute. And now that I see what's actually happening out there, I'm going to get my license in the next few weeks. We're going to advertise in QST for the Dayton. And one of the things that people, Dayton said, you know, for the money I'm spending in advertisements, the least they could do is send me a book on passing the passing the test for, actually, they gave me the general. I didn't realize I had to first take the
the technician, yeah.
Yeah, first. So anyway, I bought a technician book myself, and I'll pass that, and then I'll take the general probably a month later.
Something tells me you won't have any trouble. When were you a ham? How long ago was that?
A long time ago. My call sign at that time was WN6QDE. I don't know if that dates me or not.
It does, yeah. That was in the probably 70s, 60s.
Yeah.
So it's going to be, you can buy a 2 meter version or a 70 centimeter version. Why no dual band?
Dual band, one of the things about making these radios is I will not compromise on performance. The only way I can fit a dual band radio within the same mechanical size is to compromise on the performance of the RF stages. There's just not enough room to do what we're currently doing for both stages. To make a good dual band radio, you have to have completely separate RF stages. And to do that takes a lot of board space. You just need a bigger chassis. And to make a bigger chassis means I have to have a bigger piece of plastic, which means I have to form a new case. Not only is the case expensive, somewhere around $20,000 to $50,000, it also is about 6 months to get the first version. And if you're going to start doing that, even if I wanted to, it's going to delay the project probably close to 6 months. And I want to get the radio out now, not wait another year.
So the form factor is going to be like the one we're looking at here. And although this is not the 7,000, there isn't a 7,000 to take a picture of. That's the 700. Well,
yeah, actually, if you take a look at the CS7000 Yahoo group, that's actually a picture of the 7000. But for some reason, when I put in the file, which I believe was about a megabyte, that's what came out. And I haven't been able to put in a full size radio yet. For some reason, I try putting in a smaller version, and the thing won't change. So I'm not sure what I'm doing wrong yet, but I'll figure it out eventually.
Yeah, it's a strange size that they want you to meet. Okay, so to summarize, it's going to be DMR, Moto Turbo, D-Star, VHF version or UHF version, but not a dual bander, and coming out in the fall, assuming everything falls together the way you hope it does. And the price range, at least for radios like your 700, have been remarkably affordable. What do you sell that radio for?
We sell it to the amateurs and also to radio dealers for $180. It has It has a list price of $280, but we're selling. I have two reasons for selling it to the hams. There's actually a reason for that. If I sell it to the hams, there's a good chance they work for a public safety agency, or they know somebody who works for a public safety agency or know somebody who runs a business. And if they like the radio, they're going to tell their friends about the quality of the radio. They're going to tell about the price. And those people, in turn, are going to go to their dealer they used to deal with. And they're going to say, I like this radio. I like to get this, you know, I like the price. So instead of spending $1,000 for this Motorola radio, how about giving me this radio for, they're going to probably try to ask for $180, but the dealers have to make some profit, so they'll go $280. But even $280 versus $1,000 is still a good deal for those customers.
What kind of quality do you aim for? Are you able to match the Japanese and there's no American stuff right now, but you'd be able to match the Japanese quality?
Yes. We're from people.
If you do say so yourself, and you do.
Well, yeah. You know, actually, it's not what I say, it's what the people who have used our radios have said. Most of them are comparing them to the Motorola 6550. From a standpoint of technical, we're actually more sensitive than the Motorola. the only thing people have complained about, and not because they tried it, because it looks like a cheap radio compared to the Motorola. So somebody actually dropped the thing from, I think, from a car, and the thing actually survived it. So tells you that the quality has to be at least reasonably good.
You remind me of a story people told back in the 70s when this, before anyone was making VHF, UHF radios for hams. They brought Motorola, RCA, and GE into a dog and pony show. And the RCA guy showed his radio, and the GE guy showed his radio. And the Motorola guy's turn came up, and he walked out the door, took his radio, threw it across the room, bounced it off of the brick wall, clattered across the floor, picked it up, turned it on, and it worked. And he looked at the RCA and GE guy and said, "You want to try it?" He sold all his radios.
Yeah,
I'm not sure you want to do that.
Yeah. One of the people who used to work for me, a guy named Ray Dashner, he used to sell Fujitsu radios. And they did the same thing. They threw it against the wall, and sure enough, it still worked, and he got the sale.
And people will review your radios when they get them in their hands. They can look at the 700s now, and the 7000s when they're available, and you'll get reviewed, and people will tear them apart, and you'll not live and die, but the quality will be evident once people have a chance to actually play with them.
Yeah.
And hopefully they'll live up to what you're saying they are.
Yeah. If you want to see what other people are thinking about the radios, you know, besides the reviews, there's two Yahoo groups that have actually talked about our radios, and I run neither of them, so I can't edit anything. One is called CSI DMR, and the other is called MotoTRBO. It's MOTOTRBO. And, you know, you get users talking about the radios, you know, what's good about it, what's bad about it. And, you know, the reviews have been mostly positive. Otherwise, we wouldn't be selling more radios than we can currently get our hands on.
You have chosen DMR and D-Star for the radios. Why no P25? Why didn't you go that direction?
Okay, actually, my intention was to have the ability to do P25. The problem with getting P25 Phase 1, which is the more popular version, is you need to have what's called an IMBE vocoder. And the only people where it's available from is DVSI, and it's still, I believe, covered under patents. If I was going to use that in this radio, I'd have to spend something like $250,000 just for the privilege of getting that vocoder. Or I can spend $499 and get it as a module. And it's just out of my price range. Both, I don't want to sell a radio that you have to put a $500 part in it just to have P25, nor do I want to spend $250,000 to do that. From what I was told from other people, is that the IMBE patents will probably expire at the end of this year. And at that point, I might consider making a P25 radio.
So the 3000 chip that is going to do your MotoTRBO and your D-Star doesn't do, I guess it's now the old version of P25. P25 is upgrading, but that's not what hams are using.
Correct. In fact, what's interesting, if you look at the data sheet of the CS3000, you'll see that it says it does IMBE. So it sounds like, oh, it's perfect. We can do it. So I called up a DVSI and asked them about that. I said, yeah, it does IMBE, but P25 is a different variation of IMBE, and it doesn't do it.
But it sounds like it would be compatible with what they're going to be calling phase two of P25. And when that stuff's been around long enough, then you could do that with your current chip?
Well, at least in theory. And the reason why I say at least in theory, my guess is that I'll even have problems with that. I was originally hoping to use a modem from CMX, called the CMX, I think it's 7164. It said it does a four-level FSK, and it does it does the GMFSK, and it does about 10 other formats. But then I found out just today is that, yeah, it does that, but very limited capability. even though it does the four-level FSK, it cannot decode DMR because it has to work only, has to see particular sync codes, and the DMR sync works differently than just about every other type of system using four-level FSK. And I don't know at this time if the phase two of the P25 is compatible with the DMR protocol.
Okay. Most of that is a fair amount of Klingon for me. I'm working on reviewing this radio for QST. It's Yaesu's new version of digital, and they call it C4FM. What can you tell me about that?
Probably no more than you know. I've just heard about it in the last week. And from my gather, it's a completely different format than everybody else is using.
So, yeah, I believe it's incompatible again.
Yeah. So if I have to make a guess, only from, you know, being asked going to the amateur market, it's probably going to be a variation of NXDN. You know, maybe a completely different format, but the same basic technology.
Okay. NXDN is just yet another digital format that some of the manufacturers are building to.
Yeah. In NXDN and probably that radio, it's going to be a 6.25 kilohertz channel, and it's not going to be able to switch between two channels within a 12.5 kilohertz bandwidth. And the reason why, you know, I can even tell it's going to be like NXDN, because if it says on there C4, what does that say on the package, C4 something?
Yeah, C4, C4FM, FDMA. But I believe it's 12.5 kilohertz bandwidth.
Okay, you can... 6.25. Yeah, even with an NXDN, they can do it either 6.25 or 12 kilohertz bandwidth. So I said, I'm not familiar with that radio, but it sounds like it's going to use, from that terminology, it's probably going to use the same basic four-level FSK, you know, modem, you know, type of technology.
So, so you're not aiming to duplicate that, at least until you know more about it and see if your stuff can do it.
No, yeah, if it's not patented, I'm sure we'll find some amateur out there who's going to reverse engineer it, and he'll publish how to do it, and then I can implement it.
Okay. Yeah, I'm still learning about just, you know, from the user's perspective what those radios can do. Probably disappointed that Yaesu is choosing yet another digital incompatible mode, but there's more to learn about why they made those decisions. I want to talk a little bit about D-Star and MotoTRBO or DMR. For the parts of the audience that are not very familiar with it, you know, besides being digital modulation, there's a stuff that goes into the stream that encodes instructions to repeaters and to other radios about what to do. I'm familiar with the D-Star ones. I'm not familiar with the DMR instructions that can be put in. You know, things like your call sign and who you are, and then things like what you want a repeater to do, make connections to other repeaters using the internet as the transport mechanism, connections to reflectors. Reflectors basically just a server that concentrates a bunch of repeaters all connected together in a great big network. Those exist in both D-Star and in MotoTRBO DMR. And the radio's got to do things to tell them what to do. Your radio's going to do all that?
Yes. Yeah, we're going to be, you know, standard. It's not very difficult to implement what ICOM has done so far. The format is a relatively primitive format compared to what's done in NXDN. The D-Star protocol, at least a copy I got, is only about 12 pages or so, maybe 25 pages. The NXDN, by comparison, is at least 400 pages for the protocol. So you can see that, you know, can't even come close to putting in, you know, 12 or 25 pages the NXDN protocol. So it's you know, by comparison, it's relatively, you know, easy to implement. Not saying it's trivial, but it's relatively easy.
Do you do your own software engineering, or do you have software designers?
The answer is I've been doing software engineering since about 1966.
Before there was software?
No, before there was microcomputers. So I started out on these was actually in college. I did the first one was a GE225. Then we went to some CDC. I think it was a 6600. So I did programming mostly in Fortran at that time. For that, I did a little bit of machine coding even before that time. I took a class while I was in high school, and they didn't have any of these high-level languages available for that class. So we just learned how to program in, you know, bits and basically, you know, individual bits.
Okay, you're bringing a tear to the eye of many an old programmer.
Exactly, and but most of my programming up until about probably 10 or 15 years ago has been entirely in assembly language. I just have a good feel for that, and I like it. You can make the code a lot more efficient, play a lot of tricks to make things work better that you can't do in C, or at least very difficult to do in C. So, but in the last few years, I'm pretty much going to C, not because I like it, but because it's hard to program some of these newer microcomputers in the assembly language. They got too complicated.
Back to the radios. There's something that is special about MotoTRBO DMR, something that it does that nobody else does, and that is the two time slot capability, which is essentially having two conversations going on at the same time with two different sets of radios on the same frequency. You know, one RF channel, and one guy in one part of town is talking through the repeater, and another guy in another part of town is also talking through the repeater. They're not talking to each other. They're talking to totally different people, either in the same town or through the network around the world. How does that work?
You're basically switching back and forth between, you know, fairly high speed between the two channels, you know, channel A and channel B. Don't know the exact switching rate, but all you really need to do is switch no faster than maybe every 20 milliseconds. And you can even do slower than that if you want to buffer the voice, you know, for a quarter of a second. So it's not real difficult. You just need set up the hardware so you can do fast switching between receive and transmit.
So I'm holding my push-to-talk button down, and I'm talking. As far as I know, I am transmitting continuously, but the radio is not. The radio is going on and off and on and off, and the other guy's radio is doing the same thing. And they must be synchronized by the repeater so that one is on while the other is off. Very precise timing.
Exactly. And that's why you probably have a limitation about how far you can transmit using DMR compared to, you know, something like D-Star or NXDN. Because if you transmit, if you switch back and forth too fast, you're running into the speed of light limitations, and you're going to lose synchronization. Now, some people have claimed that with DMR, they've transmitted over 100 miles. Other people claim there's a limitation, theoretical limitation, of about 35 miles. I don't have an answer.
But I know it's more than 35 miles, because I know people that regularly talk through repeaters in this area farther than that. I don't know what the maximum might be.
Yeah, I don't either. So I never investigated it, but I know there is a maximum. But with NXDN, there's no reason why I can't transmit from here to the moon, or D-Star can transmit from here to the moon. You're not switching back and forth. Okay. It's no different than analog as far as characteristics go.
Yeah, but for terrestrial VHF and UHF, it's not such a significant limitation. I mean, hams who like to DX on FM, they might see that as a limitation, but for most routine use, it's not going to be a big deal.
Yeah, you're correct. There is one exception, and it doesn't happen very often. One person in one mountain and another person in another mountain might be farther than you can normally do otherwise because you're so high up. But that's, you know, kind of an exception.
Yep. The commercial radios, which is the roots of this radio, are typically not programmable by the user in the field using the front panel. And that's one of the reasons why I tend to stay away from them. I like to be able to make changes in frequency, tones, things like that. Oh, by the way, your radio is analog and digital, right?
Correct.
Analog is the third mode in this radio.
Yeah, and it does both 12.5 and 25 kilohertz for analog.
Okay. In terms of programming the radio, is this going to be more commercial-like, or will you, the user, be able to stand out in the street punching buttons to change frequencies and tones and stuff?
Yeah. The current version is strictly programmable by the PC. We're going to change the firmware, which will be available with no charge in the future. Can't give you an exact date, but it's just going to be a firmware upgrade, and you're going to be able to completely program the radio from the keyboard.
Okay, so that's what hams want to be able to do. But you also have software. Do you give the software away, or do you sell it?
No, we give it away. It's available for free on our website, whether or not you buy our radio.
Whoa, okay. And it takes a proprietary interface cable, or is it a standard, some kind of... No radio cable is standard these days.
Exactly. It's the actual cable is strictly wire, as opposed to some of these older cables, which has a little chip in it. It's just a Motorola two-pin connector to a USB connector, just wired between the two.
So you build your own.
You could, but it's we sell it so cheap you can't buy the parts for what we're selling it for.
Let me ask you one last question, completely out of left field. You had referred in one of the posts that you made on the Yahoo group as the radio is sort of like SDR, software-defined radio. I'm not sure how SDR you want to call it. There's arguments and disagreements about what makes SDR and what doesn't. But one of the bottom lines for me about SDR is that the mode can be changed in software. You can, if you want to take add a mode to a radio, especially a digital mode, you can do it by downloading software. Is the radio that SDR, or is it just, you know, somewhat more just software running things?
Well, the answer is because we have an analog mode, we can, in theory, implement any of the formats. So the answer is yes, it's, you know, SDR from that standpoint. But a lot of the people consider SDR only if you also do the RF portion with an SDR. The ideal SDR radio will have an A to D and DDA converter hooked up to the antenna, and anything beyond that's a compromise. So,
yeah, but well, I don't know if you're familiar with Flex. Flex is doing that in their newest systems, the HF radios, but their older systems went through a couple of conversion stages before they did their digital conversion, their A to D and D to A. And they called that SDR because they did all their modes at the low level in software.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, it depends on your definition of what SDR is. When I wouldn't want to call myself a pure SDR radio because we don't tie the computer circuitry into the directly into the RF circuitry and convert to an intermediate frequency or direct to baseband through the computer. So we have a conventional super heterodyne, you know, type of radio, you know, dual conversion super het. So we take the output of the discriminator and go to the computer, and then we take the output of the, call it the analog circuitry, DDA converter, and go into the modulator of the super het radio. So we're not, you know, pure SDR, but we do have a lot of features which cannot be done in any other radios because of the processing power that's available within our chipsets.
How long do your batteries last?
The current 700 will last about, it's rated at 11 hours for analog and 14 hours for digital if you use the industry standard terminology for, you know, what they call battery life, and that's 5% receive, 5% transmit, and 90% standby.
Yeah, that doesn't translate to ham radio very well. How else could you do it?
Exactly. So, you know, if you're comparing apples and apples, we're doing fairly well. If you use a higher capacity battery, which we sell as an option, you'll get a little bit more. The standard battery within that product is 1,700 milliamp hours, talking about the 700, and we sell a 2,000 milliamp hour battery for $30. The 7,000 is going to have, at the minimum, a 2,000 milliamp hour battery. I'm not sure if I can get anything larger within that case size. You know,
the lithium ion batteries?
Right, exactly. Okay. Yeah,
so those last a long time.
Yeah, they do. But still, if you're going to do a lot of transmitting and a lot of receiving, it's not going to last nearly as long as you expect it to.
Yeah. Rag chewing and handhelds have never gone together very well, but we still try.
Yeah, so the only solution to that, well, any good solution, you just have a couple of spare batteries in your pocket. They're small enough. So, you know, if you really want to speak for, you know, hours at a time, just have a bunch of batteries in your pocket and change them every hour or two.
Where I was really going with my question about SDR is Codec 2. Familiar with Codec 2?
Yes, I am. The answer is our architecture will allow us to put it in there, but I'm questioning whether or not we should. And the reason for that is because what good is having a Codec 2 if everybody else's D-Star radio is using the standard, AMBI, technology? So you're going to have, just our radios that are, have that Codec 2, and you won't be able to speak to any of the existing ICOM radios.
Right. It sounds like if something is developed along Codec 2, you might be able to incorporate it as a software download?
Exactly. There's absolutely no problem about putting it within the existing hardware.
Okay. One of the guys I'll be talking to soon, hopefully over this weekend and in a next episode up early next week, is Bruce Perrins, K6BP. Bruce is a big open source advocate. And he and some other hams are working on this thing called the I gotta get my big announcer voice, HT of the future, which is going to be Codec 2 based. It'll be look more like a an Android smartphone, applications and stuff like that, and multi-mode, very software defined. So whether they actually get any place or not, and they were hoping to have a working prototype at this year's Dayton. I'll find out from Bruce how close they're getting from that as soon as I talk to him. There might be some Codec 2 stuff for you to be able to talk to, and it would be cool to have a second radio available immediately to do that. Now, Codec 2 just is a codec. The actual digital implementation could be almost anything.
Right. Yeah, the processing power of the 7000 or the 700 is enough so the AMBI codec could easily work within this architecture. In fact, the 700 does use a firmware for the codec instead of the CS3000. But there's some technical reasons why I prefer to use the CS3000, even though it costs me more money to implement.
All right. Well, is there anything else about this radio and its future that I haven't covered that you think is important to get out there?
I'm going to release what I call the revolutionary features about the system. Currently, there's about 306 people on this group in the last 3 days. If I ever get to 2,000 people, I'll release all of those what I call preparatory revolutionary features. If I don't get to 2,000 by the time of the Dayton Hamvention, then I'll discuss it at that convention.
Okay, so Dayton at the latest, and earlier if this Yahoo group, I see it says 144 new members. No, 309 members. Okay. 144 of them new. I'm not sure since when. So, we need about 1,700 more, and you'll tell us the secrets. I can't pry that out of you now.
No, not at this time. I want a few.
You're on a big TV show now. You realize that there'll be tens of hundreds of people watching.
Well, then they can all join our group, and they'll get closer to 2,000.
Yep. All right. All right. I'm looking forward to it. Anything else?
Not at this time. Although people keep asking me about mobiles, we'll have a DMR mobile about October. The 7,000 version of that could follow very soon afterwards. Next year, I'm going to look into multiband radios, but I'm not going to make any commitments. It depends upon how much it costs me to develop it, how much, how the RF technology is at that time. I'd like to make a multiband portable, but the current RF technology doesn't allow me to do it and still maintain the same quality and performance as I do on a current CS700.
Let's see. It is Connect Systems. The website is connectsystems.com. You've got the Yahoo group, which is groups.yahoo.com, and then the group within that is CS7000. And those are the two places to go communicate with you. Your contact information is on your website. You're easy to get a hold of. And you're responsive on the Yahoo site. And I think you said people can call you on the phone.
So correct.
You're easy to... When do you actually have time to program?
Usually at home.
leave him alone at home, not like I'm doing here. So thank you very much, Jerry, and perhaps get a chance to see you at the Dayton Hamvention and point a camera in your face one more time.
Okay, be glad to see you at that time.
Thanks again, Jerry. Bear, did you enjoy that?
I did.
Quite a ventriloquist. Bear, have you met Arvin? That's Arvin back there. Bear and Arvin are best friends. Arvin reminds you that if you enjoyed the program and got something out of it, you can give something back. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. Stop by hamradionow.tv and click on Arvin's icon, and you can make a contribution to keep the program afloat. Thank you very much. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. See you next time. Over and out.